being able to bring forth your word today, O God. That in the storms of life, O God, that you keep us. That, Lord, you have told me, O Father God, that you are in that boat, O God, with me. And Father, I want you to use me, Father God, to impart wisdom to my brothers and sisters, O God. That we can use a wisdom that comes from above, that comes from you, and not the wisdom that comes from below, my God. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Father, I pray that you hide me behind the cross of Jesus. I am your servant, O God. Use me, O God. Use my mouth, everything that's within me. Use me, O God, to bring forth your word as you intended it to come forth. Father, and may we and I bring you honor today. And I pray this in no other name but Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. So we're going to be looking today some lessons from the storms of life. So I called it In the Eye of the Storm. So we're going to look at Luke 8 and verses 22 through 25. Thank you, Jesus. Bless your word, O God. The word of God has such power to transform our thinking. Amen. And that's why we constantly need to stay in this word. Luke 8, 22 through 25. And I'm reading from the New King James Version. Now it happened on a certain day that he got into a boat with his disciples. And he said to them, "Let us cross over to the other side of the lake." And they launched out, but as they sailed, he fell asleep, and a windstorm came down on the lake, and they were filling with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, "Master, Master, we are perishing." Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the raging of the water. And they ceased, and there was a calm. But he said to them, "Where is your faith?" And they were afraid and marveled, saying to one another, "Who can this be? For he commands even the winds and water, and they obey him." So, living in New York City, right, we really don't come across a lot of storms. We come across a lot of blizzards and but you know, it snows, it could be a blizzard, and the next day everyone is up and running. Mm-hmm. So to me, a storm, I'm like, okay, we're not affected by that, right? But we, you know, God brought to my remembrance that we did experience Hurricane Sandy. And I remember when the forecasters, they were, you know, saying that Hurricane Sandy was coming to New York City, everyone that I knew, everyone, the attitude of New Yorkers were like, really? We don't get hit with storms. That just doesn't happen here. But you know, Hurricane Sandy came and devastated one of our boroughs. And really, we were unprepared because we had a sense of entitlement that we just don't get hit with storms. So people were not prepared, right? A sense of entitlement. I myself had a certain expectation, a sense of entitlement, that when I came here to Nashville, you know, Lord, I obeyed. I'm good, I'm covered. There's not gonna be anything coming my way, right? Because I am in obedience. You told me to come here, right? But I sensed, you know, and my husband and I, we've been facing some major storms in our lives. Really, really, just a bunch of things happening. And I said, "Lord, I sense you are leading us into these storms." And I say lead because I'm not of the belief that God causes things in our lives, like he doesn't cause illness and he doesn't cause abuse or bondage. That's not the God we serve. But we have to see that he led these disciples into that storm, right? Because he said, in this world, you are going to have tribulation.
Amen.
Right? He said it. Yet, I also believe today, right, that God allows this for the development of our character.
Amen.
Because sometimes our character, no matter where we think we are, our character is frail, and there is something going on deep inside that God wants to work out. I have sensed since Thursday that I have been set up by the Holy Ghost.
Hallelujah.
And God used this man to set me up. I was like,
thank you, Lord.
Pastor Donald
texted me
on Thursday and he says, I need you to speak on Sunday.
Glory.
So my response was, Sunday with a question mark? I said, does this, he not know? He knows what's going on. I'm like, he is quite aware of everything. I need to hear a word from God. I need to sit under him and receive what God has for me. And then the next thing he says, and God said that you would resist. Right? So I said, Lord, the minute I read that, I remember in and out of season, right? We have to be ready. In and out of season. I heard the Lord say, I want you to teach them the lessons in the storm. So as I said, I've been going through a lot of major storms, so I just want to share some of the things that we've been going through. My husband was very ill this week, right? Kind of threw me off because my husband is kind of always healthy, and I was very concerned for him. My stepson, my mother-in-law, my sister-in-law, all in the hospital around the same time. We had some issues going on with our nephew, and we're trying to get him in school. There's some issues going on that we're like, Lord, what is going on? The foundation of our home was cracked, and our home was actually sinking, right? So we had to hire a company that first said to us, oh, it's, you know, we got it on time. It's going to be $3,000. We're like, oh, my God. I never thought that I would praise God for spending $3,000, but okay. Because I know that this is, you know. But then when they came in again and they saw how faulty it was, they're like, it's not going to be $3,000. It's going to be $15,000. So I began to think, the New Yorker in me said, these people are cheating. Right? So I start, you know, getting, why do I know they're telling us the truth? And blah, 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 blah. Okay. You know, I just went through my whole gamut of emotions. Then we had my daughter-in-law struggling with something. And I said, Lord, everything at once. A dear, dear friend of mine, pastor, you know, lost his life. Not lost his life. Went to be with the Lord. Mm-hmm. But he lost his battle with cancer after 5 years. I don't understand what God is doing. As I was preparing this message, the drilling, the house was shifting as they were drilling, that the Bible fell off my computer table. And I said, Satan, don't mess with me. Because you can throw it down, but I will step on that Bible, and I will stand on the Word of God. You know? But it was just insanity going on. So that's what I want to do. I want to share with you the lessons that I've learned in this storm. Lesson number one, that the Lord led them into the storm. Jesus said, let us cross over to the other side of the lake. Did Jesus know what was going to happen when they went to the other side of the lake? Was he aware of it? He was in total control. He knew exactly what was going to happen, right? He knew that these experienced fishermen would go into a great storm, a violent storm, that they would not be able to handle on their own ability.
Mm-hmm.
There are times, my brothers and sisters, when we begin to depend on our intellect, on our resources, on our ability, or on someone else's ability to get us out of our storms and to lead us out, right? We forget, and I know that I forgot, that God guides each and every step that I take, that he orders the steps So if I believe that, then I have to believe.
Say that.
He's guiding me, leading me into that storm, right? And I, he is there with me.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
We forget that God is sovereign and that he, right? He's there, okay. We forget that he's sovereign and that he knows everything. The beginning to the end, he's Alpha, he's Omega, right?
Come on.
So there are times that when storms come and he's gonna allow, I believe for me this was a storm of correction to come, right? He's gonna allow storms to come, again, for character development, to come to a greater knowledge of who he is in our lives, to take our focus off of the problem, off of ourselves, and to put our focus back on the creator of heaven and earth, right? To demonstrate to us the level of our faith. He knows where we're at. But sometimes we think we're in a level that we're not. Okay? He wants us to trust him, right? Or he wants us to see that we're really not trusting him and we're trusting something else. Storms will make us more compassionate towards others. When you go through something in life, you know what happens? You kind of feel more compassion for people. Because you can turn kind of, our hearts sometimes can turn, or maybe cold, or turn it off a little. 2 Corinthians says this, and I'm reading 2 Corinthians 1, 3 to 4. It says, praise to the God of what? Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive from God. In the storm, we have a greater awareness of God's presence. We begin to experience God in a greater way, right? We begin to experience the character of God. For me, I saw his mercy for a rebellious child, right? I saw his grace upon my life. I saw that even though I was going through my tantrums, that he loves me. Yeah. And that he was sovereign, that no matter what I did, he was still in control, right? I saw his faithfulness to me, his goodness, and his majesty. Father, you are king. You are king over the flood. That's what I saw.
Amen.
Jesus led those disciples right into the storm. He was working something out in them. In fact, Christ led them into the storm, not because they were, it wasn't because of disobedience. They were doing pretty good before that, you know? It was because he had to do a greater work in them.
Right.
He could not leave them. These men, he says, I need these men to spread the gospel, right? I need to do a greater work in them. I'm sure that they probably were thinking, you know what? If I stayed in the shore, we would not experience the storm. But in the shore, there's no depth with God. You can't stay in the shore and be with God, right? I said to the Lord, you know, I have to confess, I can't be nothing but transparent with you because that's who I am. You know, I was praying or complaining, whatever you want to call it, saying to the Lord, you know what, Lord? If we were in New York, this wouldn't be happening. We wouldn't be feeling the pinch financially because you know what? We both had excellent jobs and this would be nothing. You know, the son, right? We would be able to go see him at the hospital. If I, that's all I kept hearing myself say. If I. And I heard God said, there is no I in God. This is not about you. While the disciples and I might have a different storm, a different set of emotions, right? We were still feeling pretty much the same thing. We were because we were not in control of our storm. And I know in the past, God has dealt with my control issues. But obviously, I didn't learn the lesson. I began to say, God, don't you care? I'm dying here. Don't you, you know, the disciple says, don't you care if we perish? I'm dying here, Lord. Don't you care? But let me give you the answer that God gave me as I was praying and I was seeking in the Bible for a word of comfort or a word from God. He led me to this scripture, Job 38:4-6. I'm going to let you get there a little bit. Job 38:4-6. And this is God's answer to Job when Job started questioning him. He says, where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Then he says, tell me if you have understanding, who determined its measurements? Surely you know. Or who stretched the line upon it? To what were its foundations fastened? Or who laid its cornerstone? And I was like, what kind of answer is this? Right? But I began to pray and say, I know you're speaking to me here, Lord. So I went further into the word to see what was happening here. He was responding to Job's questions, right? And I'm not going to say, you know, I don't want to say that it's wrong to question the Lord, right? I think it's rather normal and healthy when you go to the Lord and question him. However, however, come to the Lord with respect and honor, realizing that he's perfect in wisdom and that he knows all things. He may not always reveal the answers to everything and the questions that you have, but you can rest assured that he has got you in the palm of his hand. And no one, no trouble, no nothing will be able to take you out of his hands.
Thank you.
Amen? Deuteronomy 29:29 says the secret things belong to the Lord.
Yeah.
So there are going to be some things, right, that belong to the Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
God had to respond in that way because I was coming to him with that sense of entitlement, thinking that I'm going to get my way, thinking that because I'm obeying you, why are you doing this to me? I don't understand. It was almost like I really felt an attack, right? And then, as I was praying, I remember the story of the three Hebrew boys, right? In the book of Daniel. All right. Their obedience led them to the fury, right, to the furnace. And it was so hot. It was so that they weren't even touched.
Right.
And in that furnace, there was a fourth person.
Come on.
The fourth person. One was like God, they said, who we recognize as Christ.
Oh, Lord.
In your storm, there is the presence of the living God. While your boat is swaying from side to side, while the winds are high, you will not perish. There is a presence that can either going to do two things. It's going to calm the storm, or it's going to calm the child within the storm.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. In the book of Isaiah, this is a promise. I'm going to give you all these promises, and really, you should be jotting them down because you're going to need them one day. Learn from me, right? In the book of Isaiah 43, right? I'm going to start. It says, I think it's verse 1 through 28. It says, but now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel. What does he say? Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You know what? God knows us by name. He's not up there in heaven saying to the angels, who was that acting up before? No, he knows me by name.
Say it.
You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you go through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Cush and Seba in exchange for you. And I love this, because you are precious in my sight. You are precious in my eyes, and I honor and I love you. I give men in return for you, people in exchange for your life. Fear not, for I am with you. Amen. Tremendous promise that keeps me grounded on knowing, right? God, you are with me. You are always with me.
Amen.
You are with me in that storm. The Lord never leaves us. He never forsakes us. Even when heaven seems silent, right?
Yeah.
We need to stand by faith and trust that he is there with us.
Amen.
Notice something in this story. Jesus waited until they gave up on their own abilities, right? Because again, I'm sure they knew a lot of storms. They were like, we got this. You know, we're used to this. We're out there. They knew how to navigate through the storm, but when they gave up, that's when Jesus stepped in. Right? Right? I wanna give you another promise. Look at Hebrews 13:5. And this to me is a big one. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you. Never will I forsake
you. Thank you, Lord.
You know what the Lord told me in this? Money will come and money will go, but the provision of the Lord is always with us.
Amen.
Amen.
That's good.
Amen.
Right? There's going to be seasons where money's going. There's going to be seasons where money's gone. But the money is not the issue.
All right.
The issue is the provision of the Lord.
Yeah.
Thank you, Pastor.
Yes.
You have taught me that.
Amen.
Promise number two, Romans 8:35-39 says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword?
All right.
As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all of these things, we are more than conquerors. Say that. We are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
The love of God remains unchanged in every season of our lives. Just because we're going through it doesn't mean that God doesn't love us.
Amen.
You know what? He's even loving us harder at that time, because he doesn't want to leave us in our mess.
All right, now.
Amen?
Amen.
Lesson number two. Storms reveal certain areas in our lives that need to be changed. Storm often exposes how we're not trusting God. You know what? We can fake it in the calm waters, right? We can even impress others how spiritual we are. When a storm comes that we know we can handle, but I'm staying firm. Lord, I'm trusting in you. We're faking it all the way. The disciples at first thought they could handle the storm. We have handled so many storms in our lives that we begin to think that we can handle every storm, right? A crisis will show you a side of you that you're blinded to. And this is what the storm did for me, right? The Lord used this storm to show me that there were some areas in my life that I needed to now begin to trust God in some areas that I probably didn't trust him because I didn't need to, because I was self-sufficient. I didn't need to trust him in that area. Financially, I didn't need to trust him, but now I do, right? weakness. Mm-hmm. I had to admit my weaknesses to the Lord in order for God to become strong in me. Mm-hmm. I was like, God, this is where I'm at. Mm-hmm. Yes, you, and this is where I'm at. I'm messed up. Storms also reveal our distorted view of the problem. I'm going to say that again. Mm-hmm. Storms will also reveal our distorted view of the problem. The disciples, excited, right? They were excited. They cried, Master, Master, we're perishing. They thought they were all going to drown. But wait a minute here. Who was on board with them?
All right.
God's promised Messiah. To think that the long-awaited Messiah would perish in the bottom of the Sea of Galilee is absurd. It's ridiculous. But while we are in the storm and we're not focusing on God and we're focusing on the problem, we get a distorted view of the problem.
Amen.
Storms also reveal our distorted view of the Lord Jesus. The disciples said, who is this that the winds, right? Listen to and the waves. Who is this? That was the problem. They didn't really know who he was. If they had known, they would have been at peace with what Jesus was, right? So they also had to come to the realization of who Jesus was, who he really was to them. We do the same thing when we panic in a crisis. That's the worst thing to do because your mind shuts down and you don't even know what you're thinking or doing. You know, but this is what I know for me in this problem. I was trying to solve everything. Okay, you know, even journal, you know, let me see how I'm gonna figure this all out. I had to come up with a plan, except I negated the supernatural power of Christ in my life because I wanted to figure it out. Mm-hmm. Our distorted view of the problem, right, leads us to a distorted view of Jesus. Because Luke doesn't say it, but Mark says this, Lord, don't you care that we're perishing? I'm sure, this is not biblical, but I'm sure it was Peter. Don't you care, Lord? Right? Don't you care that we're perishing, right? In a time of severe trial, it is easy to doubt that God loves us. It's just so easy to do. Always remember that God is a safe dwelling place in life storms. He is our safe dwelling place. Jesus said to his disciples, they will reach the other side. Mm-hmm. I have a friend that always says to me, don't put a question mark where God put a period, right? Jesus said, we will reach the other side. If the Lord says something to you, what is going to happen? He is not a liar, right? It will happen.
Thank you, Lord.
So if he said they will reach the other side, no matter how high the winds were, they reached the other side. I was like, Lord, what was on the other side? I had to go back. I said, Lord, let them know. What was on the other side of that storm for them? On the other side, when they got to the other side, it was that demon-possessed man that was in the grave, and they had to tie him down, and he kept breaking loose, right? And that Jesus had to come. They saw a great miracle of Jesus on the other side.
Yeah.
On the other side of your storm, there's a great miracle coming. There is something that you will say, look at what the Lord has done. Amen?
Amen.
Lesson number 3. Where is your faith? Jesus asked the disciples this very important question. Where is your faith? And church, I need to ask you today that question. Where is your faith? Right? Where is your faith? Where do you put your trust in? Where do you put your confidence in? Is it in yourself, your strength, your own abilities? Where is your faith today? No human being can live without faith, right? We all have faith in something. The difference between the believer and the unbeliever is the object of their faith, which is in Christ Jesus. But even the non-believer, they have faith. They have faith in their own ability, right? Hebrews 11:6 says that without faith, it is impossible to please God.
Amen.
We can't please God without faith. So I have this question. I woke up Thursday night, and this question was resounding in my spirit. At 3 o'clock in the morning, I heard, "Where is your faith, Maria? Where is your faith? Is it in your intellect? Is it in your wisdom? Is it in your resources? Is it in the doctors, the medicine? Is it in the people that claim that they're going to fix your foundation? Is your faith in them? Right? Is your faith in the fact that you just think that you are obedient? Is your faith in that? Where is your faith?" I had to come to the realization that my faith was in everything else. And the problems in the everything else, I was looking at everything else beside and not looking at the one that can do for me. That can say, "Peace be still," to that storm, and everything would have been. I was not looking at that. I was looking at every way on how to figure this out. And so I think for you, right, we need to be people, right, to learn wisdom. I'd rather learn a wisdom from someone else than learn it from life's experience, because life experience hurts. Right? I'm just saying, it hurts. And we as believers, right, this is where we're at as believers. We're either entering a storm, in the midst of a storm, or we're exiting a storm. Right? That's going to be entering a storm, in the midst of a storm, or exiting a storm. But I want you to think, so right now I want you to think about whether you're going through a storm right now. I want you to think about that storm. Or maybe if you're not, think about a previous storm that you have dealt with. And I have this question to ask you that Jesus asked his disciple. Where is your faith? Where is it? Is your faith in man's ability? Is your faith in your resources? Is your faith in the doctors? Where is your faith today? So as I said, right, it's easy to trust God when everything in life is smooth sailing. And that's what I told my husband. Yeah, we can say we trust God when it's smooth sailing, but when a great storm comes, right, this is what question we have to answer. Where is our faith? So the lessons that I've learned, because that's what God said, right? Share with them the lessons. These are the lessons I learned. I learned that God is sovereign, and I'm not. He taught me to have faith in him and not in anything else. I learned that God leads us into the storms to draw us to him and to get a greater revelation of who he is. This storm brought me to my knees in worship. I haven't been on my knees for a while. Yeah, I sit and pray in my rocking chair, but brought me to my knees. I can truly answer the question in this story, who is this man? He is the living God, my creator, my Abba, my daddy who loves me, and one who's in control of my life. Once again, I saw God's mercy and his grace towards me. Right? Because I don't know if I was a, get away from me, you know? Enough. But no, that's not the way. He still said, use this man to say, you know what? Listen, get her to speak so that she can see all these lessons in this story. Because I was too busy. I couldn't even read the Bible. You know what I'm saying? So, I've learned that better is one day in his courts than a thousand elsewhere. I'd rather be in the storm with God, and today I could honestly say that, than be in the shore out of his will.
All right, yeah. All right.
God has revealed to me areas in my life with darkness. He needs to shine his light. He needs to take me to that place. And I have to say that last week, I came here, I felt totally disconnected from the body, completely disconnected, and I shared that with you. You know, but the Lord said, why do you think I put you there?
All right.
There's a reason. I was like, God, tell me the reason, because I don't know. Tell me that reason, right? Pastor Donald is the most emotionally stable person that I know in my life.
I agree with that.
You know, I've always said that to him. How do you remain so calm, right? And if I'm to lead this ministry of helping people with their toxic emotions, I need to glean from him. So I'm calling you publicly to task, to teach me how to remain emotionally stable in my life.
All right.
What else happened to me in this storm? I was counseled by the person of the Holy Spirit. There is no greater counseling than that.
Come on.
When he came alongside of me to say, I mean, stop it. Listen. To hear what he needed to say. I learned that storms can only be still in our lives when we call the master stormtrooper, right? And only by the word of God and prayer is how we can stay calm in the season. You know, I told Pastor Donald that I wanted to put a Bible under the foundation of our home, but I couldn't part with one. I was like, no, I like this one. No, I like this one. I'm not putting the Bible. But we did put, we put a note, Psalms 91, and we wrote a note on there that if in the future generations for anyone to come, that we stood on Christ the solid rock.
All right.
And that all other ground is sinking sand. And we put Psalms 91, believing God for the protection of our home.
Mm.
And so that now is under our foundation.
Mm.
The foundation of our home may have been crumbling, but thank God that the foundation that we have in Christ is solid.
Amen.
Amen. You know, I've also learned that I don't have to trust people. I really don't have to trust, you know, people that I don't know, like these contractors, right? I didn't have to trust them because God will compel them to do the right thing for us.
Amen.
There was one time, my son works for Delta, and we fly standby. So we were going to Orlando. And there was, when we landed in Atlanta, there was a plane that was just boarding, right? And I said to him, let's run to that gate. And my son's like, we're never going to make it. I said, but let's try. I mean, we're here, right? So we ran to the gate. And they put the kids in. They put my son in. But they couldn't get my daughter-in-law and I on the flight. And there were seats, but something was going on with the computer. So the supervisor comes, says, why is this plane still on the ground? And the woman is like, I'm trying. You never hold up a plane for standby passengers, never, right? But the supervisor comes and she's like, and she's doing it so hard, she's so angry. And I said, but God will compel you to put us on that plane whether you want to or not, right? And that's what God reminded me. He said, it doesn't matter. You don't have to trust them. Trust me.
Yes.
Those guys work harder than anything. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. Another valuable lesson I learned is that my history with God will repeat itself. As God has led me out of other storms, He has kept me. And my history should have said, I know that God's going to, He's got this, right?
Mm.
You know, King David, right, in 1 Samuel 17 says this, the Lord that delivered me out of the paw of the lion, out of the paw of the bear, he will deliver me out of the hand of the Philistines. Mm. David was recounting his history with God, mm. right? Just as God delivered me in the past, he will deliver me from this great giant. Mm. And we need to remember those things. Mm. We need to recount them and say, you know, the God who did this, the God who did that, the God. That's why we can't, that's why, for me, journaling is important to remind me. Well, because we forget. Yeah. Listen, I could do something today, and by tomorrow, my mind, it's done. So I journaled it so that I can remember the goodness of God in my life. Amen. My dear brothers and sisters, my pastor, I pray that you will continue to pray for my husband and I. And this is what I want you to pray, that we will remain faithful. I want to hear those words one day. Well done, good and faithful servant. I don't want to hear you of little faith, right? And this is my conclusion. Are you going through a storm today? Maybe the Lord led you into the storm so that he will draw close. You will draw closer to him. Maybe the storm is nothing more than an attack from Satan. Maybe it's just part of life. Whatever it is, don't give up. Trust in the Lord and know that he has you in his hand, that he is in the boat with you. One thing I promise you is if you trust God through your storm, you're going to go into such a wonderful fellowship, deep fellowship with him, that it may be the sweetest fellowship that you experience on this side of eternity. Because that's what I've seen. In the storms of life, we can remain still and peace. Because in your storm, right, the maker of heaven is in that boat with you. You will get to the other side. I will get to the other side. We collectively will get to the other side. In Jesus' name. So peace be still. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Father God, we just thank you. We just add our faith to their faith in the name of Jesus. And we declare, Father God, that everything that they may be facing right now, we thank you that there is greater glory on the other side. Mm-hmm. Father God, we declare right now in the name of Jesus that they are victorious, that they are the head and not the tail. And I declare, Father God, that even in the midst of the attack, we will see the supernatural provision of God for
Say
their
that.
Life in a strange and an unusual and an unexpected way.
All right, now.
We thank you, Father God, that you will keep them, that you will establish them, and that even in the midst of all this, we declare that their character shall be proven.
Hallelujah. Yes.
And we thank you, Father God, for them, and we give you glory in
glory.
Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
God love you both. Amen. Amen. God bless you.